Today, on behalf of entire JLPMR family, I feel highly privileged in extending a warm welcome to our renowned guests, Major General Dilawar Singh Ji, Senior Vice President of Global Economist Forum, AO, ECOSOC, that's Economic and Social Council, United Nations. Mr. Sanjeev Kumar Ji, ex-head HR, Bajaj Power. I also welcome Mr. Dilip Sinha Ji, Head Human Resources at JSW Steel. Mr. Rakesh Sethi Ji, Business Consulting Facilitator, Author and Speaker. Dr. Ajay Kumar Ji, Director, JL Bajaj Institute of Management and Research. All the faculty members of JLBIMR, and a warm welcome to all the participants who have joined us far around the globe in this very special Business Summit 2020 on reorientation of HR practices post-COVID-19, how to adapt and evolve. So before we begin with the summit, let us all invoke the blessings of Goddess Saraswati. I would request you all to please join us in the prayer. May I request our IT to please start the video of the prayer. Divine grace of God be with us today and always. JLBIMR is extremely delighted. While organizing today's business summit, the institute was established in 2007 under visionary guidance of Sri Pankaj Agarwalji, Vice Chairman, JL Bajaj Group of Institutions. We run two-year PGDM program with an objective to provide a great platform to the students where they can embark on their journey towards a successful career. The very objectives of today's virtual business summit is to get insights of our expert speakers on reorientation of HR practices post-COVID-19, various HR measures being taken and envisaged by businesses in India, redefining role of HR amid COVID-19. So we really will look forward to understand the actual business scenario with the experts' view today. Before we start with the discussion, with permission, I would like to give brief introduction of our illustrious guests of the day. We feel delighted to have presence of Major General Dilawar Singh Ji, a Senior Vice President of Global Economist Forum, AO, ECOSOC, Economic and Social Council, United Nations. Sir is former National Director, NYKS, Government of India. Previously, he was Vice President of Sports and served as Committee Member, National Scheme for Sports, Khelo India, under Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. He was also member of National Youth Development Fund Board, which is also part of Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports, Government of India. He has been at crucial positions at various ministries of Government of India. We warmly welcome and thank you, sir, for joining us today. We also have amongst us Mr. Sanjeev Kumar Ji, ex-head HR, Bajaj Power. Previously, he was designated as Vice President CHR in Hindustan Power Project Private Limited. Also, he was Head HR at Jindal Power Limited. He has always been at top HR positions in various reputed companies such as Essar Oil Limited and ONGC. We warmly welcome you, sir. We also have been joined by Mr. Dilip Sinha ji, Head Human Resources at JSW Steel. He brings 23 years of rich experience in the area of human resource management. He was awarded amongst the top 100 most talented CHRO in Asia by World HR Congress in 2015 and 2016. Previously, he was associated with Reliance Retail as Head Human Resources. He also led the HR team at Future Group. Once again, hearty welcome, sir. And we also have presence of renowned business consultant, facilitator, author, and speaker, Mr. Rakesh Seth ji. He has over 30 years of experience. Mr. Rakesh was Senior Vice President at Lloyd India and also worked with Tata Thapar's Anand, Shriram Honda, Eternit, Everest, LNGV. He advises on leadership, business management, organizational development. He has trained executives of large Indian organizations like ONGC, NHPC, NTPC. A warm welcome, sir. I now move to a brief introduction of Dr. Ajay Kumar, sir, Director, Jail Bajaj Institute of Management and Research. With 32 years of experience in academics, research, training, and consultancy, sir has been at the director position in many institutions such as ITS, Asian School of Media Studies, International Chamber of Media and Entertainment Industries, BLS Institute of Technology and Management, and many more. He has also been honorary member of Cambridge Who Is Who. With these words, I would now like to invite our director, Dr. Ajay Kumar, sir, for the welcome address. Please, sir.
Very good morning to all the honorable guests and my dear participants. On behalf of JL Bajaj Institute of Management and Research, I take this opportunity to officially welcome you all again for a discussion on a very pertinent topic, which is not only important for HR fraternity, but is also important for the society at large. All of you know that the future has always been uncertain, but today we feel that it has become more uncertain about that than we ever did. The physical and mental well-being of people, organizations, and entire societies is under enormous threat, dramatically changing the priorities of business leaders. There are clear implications for HR. It must redefine its focus area to shift its attention to what we think are the most critical needs. We need to work on how to stabilize and heal the workforce. The workforce will need to heal from the emotional toll of this abrupt change. Although it is impossible to predict the level of harm and damage comparisons to 2008 financial crisis, the 1929 depression, and even World War II seem adequate at best and insufficient at worst. CHROs will need to help employees and their families too deal with the health and financial issues this crisis has created. HR in general will need to provide more support because employees will not be able to focus on work until they feel they and their families are safe and that mental and financial health issues are being supported and addressed too. So challenges are manifold. People are worried in general, those who are working in the organizations and those who have been asked to stay away from the workforce for the time being. Employees remaining after mass layoffs will have additional issues, including survivor guilt, which will need to be addressed. These will be deeper and broader than we have ever seen on this globe. We may see more involvement with the staff who were laid off since government may not be able to support them, and to be very frank, government will not be able to support them in ways they have tried in the past. And if we don't, our current employee base will not be able to heal. There will be a strong need for a clear debrief of how we handle the crisis, including feedback from employees on what worked and what didn't. This will require direct and caring communications, since many companies may have wanted to do X but could not afford to, and helping employees understand that this will be the only way to maintain or recover the minimum level of trust needed to keep people engaged. Clearly, organizations will also need to reassess their policies and practices around short-term disability and pay to see if they are robust enough to resist not just today's crisis, but similar future crises. So challenges are manifold. The future otherwise looks bleak, but human being has always survived and has always succeeded too. So I personally believe that though HR challenges may be many, though it will be a difficult time, but I believe that though the ride will not be smooth, but the HR policies, reinvented policies, redefined policies will definitely lead to a better working environment, work culture also, and smooth functioning of the organizations too. With these words, I would like to close my statements or my session here with again immense talk. Thanks to all the guests, Major General Dilawar Singh, Sanjeev Singh, Dilip Kumar, Rakesh Sethi ji, and all the participants too. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your words. Indeed, challenges are there, and it's just that human mind has to again re-strategize things and to go ahead with the new opportunities. Thank you so much, and we have already been joined by around more than 140 participants, and we are expecting more as per the registrations. One request to all the participants, we'll soon start the session, a speak-up session. If anyone has any query in between that, you are requested to please write in the chat box. Once the speakers are done with their session, I would ask those queries on behalf of you all. So now, moving forward to inviting our guest, I would first like to invite a very renowned personality, Major General Dilawar Singh ji, to please deliberate upon the topic. Please, sir.
Thank you, Aparna. Thank you so much. Dear Mr. Pankaj Agarwal ji, Dr. Ajay Kumar ji, both from the GL Bajaj Institute of Management and Research, really thank you for giving me the opportunity to share the good time with you. Respected Mr. Sanjeev Kumar ji, Mr. Dalip Sinha ji, Rakesh Sheth ji, and all our dear participants, I indeed feel privileged to be amongst each one of you today. Thank you so much. So first thing to start with is Jai Hind. Jai Hind to everybody.
Jai Hind, sir.
And how's the Josh?
Hi, sir.
I feel that after listening to Prime Minister Modi yesterday in Leh, that each one of you is positively assured and feeling stronger and better.
Indeed. Without doubt.
I'm indeed grateful to all of you for giving me this opportunity on this very important topic. And why I say that is that the first thing, we all are uniquely lucky to get this opportunity to discuss HR. HR is the most critical component of any organization, country or a company. And discuss the practices therein and the need to reorient, and especially post-COVID. I personally thank COVID because we had got into a situation where we were all racing with different kind of things, and we were not getting time either for ourselves or for the family, or to stop and think as to what we are doing, why we are doing, and how we are doing. COVID has brought the biggest opportunity in the history of mankind so far. It has brought about a huge opportunity for transformation. Transformation starting from the common man itself, right up to the largest corporates, as well as the nation itself and the global community itself. We are also lucky that while we were undergoing this first shock of COVID, that our neighbor China has brought in some activity which has compelled to make us think about Atmanirbhar Bharat. And this Atmanirbhar Bharat will come about by making each one of us as Atmanirbhar. And as Professor Ajay was saying, that governments in any country and any part of the history will never be able to fulfill all the requirements. The best is for each one of us to be Atmanirbhar as best and as much as we can, because that is the actual solution. And while these two big issues were confronting us, we also have a third issue, and that is the state of our economy. So these three challenges, each one of them is going to impact all of us. Globally, the pandemic is affecting, and as far as domestically within the country is concerned, our activities of our neighbors, whether it be China or Pakistan, and also the state of our economy. All these are going to be affecting us. But I can say one thing. You all have heard that song. Aane wala pal. So what I have to say about it is that this aane wala kal mushkil wala hai. Lekin aane wala pal jaane wala bhi hai. और फिर आने वाला उससे भी अच्छा पल वो भी आने वाला है. वी ऑल हैव टू प्रिपेयर आवरसेल्व्स फॉर द डिफिकल्ट टुमारो एंड द ब्यूटीफुल डे आफ्टर. वी विल बी फेसिंग द इश्यूज ऑफ डिमांड श्रिंकेज. लार्ज अमाउंट ऑफ इंडस्ट्री इज ऑल्सो ऑलरेडी फेसिंग द डिमांड श्रिंकेज. We are also facing the shrinkage of liquidity. We are facing in different segments of the industry. In some industry, we are facing a pileup of the inventory. And certain other parts of the sectors of industry, we are facing the shortage of inventory. Very shortly, we are going to find numerous changes. We started just seeing minor changes. These minor changes are going to develop into major changes. The restrictions on travel, the restrictions of mobility, be it the train, be it the metro, be it the public transport, the rising cost of petrol and diesel, they all are creating some very genuine difficulties for the entire workforce, be it the executive level, be it the mid level, and be it the bottom level. We are also having difficulties with regard to the educational industry, if I may call it. The educational institutions, they are undergoing a long period of closure. We are already seeing the wearing out, the stress among the law enforcing agencies, the police. You all have seen that initially when it all started, everybody was in josh. They all are getting tired now. You'll find this problem in the healthcare also. All our doctors and nurses and other people involved there in the healthcare industry, they are going to be finding a very serious sort of situation of stress and wearing out. So in certain very critical industries, you'll find the shortage of manpower. The HR is going to become a very, very heavy premium aspect, which will very strongly seek a very strong attention towards it. The impact of COVID is going to make us to redesign our workplaces, redesign our safety and security aspects of each industry, be it sanitization, be it the distancing. Both are going to demand a lot of changes. India being the kind of country that we are, we have space at premium. We have services at premium. Every small change is going to add extra expenditure to it. The aspect of distancing is going to cause its own imperatives. The expenditure towards the pandemic and the armed forces within the country's government will increase. The government will have to increase the expenditure for the pandemic. The government will also now have to increase the expenditure for equipping and assisting the armed forces because of the China thing. And because of the kind of state of economy, because of itself and also due to the pandemic, there is a demand for large amount of infusion of equity. The economic package, what has been discussed and is being released gradually, all these things will demand more and more of money from the government. At the same time, the revenue collection by the government is under a lot of stress. Every industry which has undergone a closure and is undergoing further difficulties will have lesser productivity, lesser revenue generation, and therefore lesser taxation. And same is going to be on the direct taxes from the individuals. And that is where the government is going to sort of increase the petrol and diesel and other things where they can sort of shore up and make up the revenues that they need. They will be under pressure to also sell their assets. On one hand, the problem of selling the assets will be there. On the other, the earlier situation not being there, the price that they will get for these assets is going to be not as much. So there will be challenges for doing. So this is the broad sort of situation which is emerging. And in this broad situation that is emerging, we have to be optimistic. We have to be positive and we have to create relevant strategies for HR. HR, when I say, I mean that not only the HR which is employed with us, but also their families. This is the added kind of responsibility that we are going to get into now. If we are not able to take care of the families, the output and productivity of our HR is going to be serious. Next issue is that of the migrant population. The migrant population, as it has returned to UP, Bihar and its native places, is creating a big situation. The effects of that we will keep, or rather start seeing now. And HR being linked within the organizations and externally with the social environment will demand more and more of attention. The immediate reactions by various companies towards the COVID and the situation were varied, and mostly the Indian companies, they had a certain kind of thought process towards it. They started looking at the compensation restructuring, bringing down the compensations. They started to think of redeployment and reskilling. They started to think of deferment of increments and promotions. They started to think about the managing temporary employees, the aspect of furlough leave and compensatory working, holding off the performance pay and the bonuses, retrenchments, terminations, outplacement and career transitioning, temporary shutdowns, suspensions, and some have sort of also gone into employee communications, and few of them are now looking at HR policies and their procedure manuals very, very seriously and strictly. But at the same time, let me also share with you, whatever I interact with the industry, I find that whereas the larger corporates have gone into the first phase of immediate procedures and practices being revamped, the short term, the coming short term and the coming long term scenarios have not been actually visualized by many. And large number of our HR leaders have actually not started focusing on what we are going to face very shortly and what we are going to face in the interim and the long term. Whereas the larger corporates, the global corporates, as far as they are concerned, as far as their initial sort of reaction to the pandemic is concerned, they immediately, some of them have created their crisis management teams. And these crisis management teams have started immediately looking at the succession contingency plans for all the major executives. They've started looking at the business going virtual, restricting the travel of the employees, both on short-term and long-term basis, domestic as well as international, reducing the business critical operations only, reducing it only to the critical operations, moving critical operations to unaffected regions, although that also is now coming under a bit of stress because the pandemic is spreading everywhere. The cross-training of the team members so that they can handle the emergencies of absence, the documenting of the business critical functions and distributing the call center scripts and agent communication so that the transition is handled. As far as the pandemic is concerned, they have also sort of instructed their own staff to report in case they become a positive, also inform in case their families get affected, and various measures to quarantine and to give them sort of paid leave or paid time off and staggering of timings, working from home, all that has been done. Now, the meetings, as we all are now also on the Zoom meeting, so in a way, the opportunities have expanded, but as far as the companies are concerned, their face-to-face meetings are reduced, and rightly so. Now, most of these global companies are very seriously thinking of the well-being of their employees and also the well-being of their families. And huge number of measures have been sort of considered and announced by most of the companies, be it the sick leave, extended sick leave, vacation time, part-time off, flexi time, staggering time, utilization, short-term disability, their insurances, mental health services, stress management programs, backup care programs, so many of them. Most of the companies are also now sort of shifting to various technologies, both for official regular communication as well as for the social and informal communications. And huge amount of procedures are now being sort of redefined in order to take care of this. There is also a huge amount of training and retraining aspect that has come into it, especially for the online training. And when people are not going to be working on site and offline, they're going to be working. So this offline working needs a totally different kind of monitoring and management by objectives and taking care of their other sort of needs as well. So all this is going on. And while all this is going on, we need to look at the options not only for the work from home, but work from hometown. This is also the emerging concept that not only do you have to work from home, you can work from your hometown as long as the productivity is ensured to the required degree. Number of IT companies especially, they have had a major change. Their output study has indicated that they've been able to cut down the costs when they've allowed the work from home, and the productivity, instead of reducing, by good management, they have been able to enhance productivity. On an average, large number of these IT companies have been able to at least get up to 110% of productivity with reduced cost of work from home. By that, they have already started taking decisions to dehire their large offices because they are cutting down on the office cost, they are cutting down on the travel cost, they are cutting down on the other facilities like gym and cafeteria and other all other things. I can tell you that Google, Microsoft, Convergent, Infosys, all these companies have already served notices to their building owners that they want to vacate about 60 to 70% of their workspace, office space that they were occupying. So this is also going to cause additional job shrinkage in terms of the transport people, in terms of the hospitality people, the housekeeping staff, the cleaning staff, the air condition management staff, the electricity staff, the plumbing staff, and so on and so forth and so on. So these are the additional number of people who are going to be available in the market for hiring, for reskilling, for re-engagement, for transitional requirements. So large number of organizations, instead of de-hiring their people, they have gone in for business process re-engineering, product redefinition, and some of the companies have not de-hired a single person. They have in fact remodeled their business and they've been able to pay more to their employees instead of cutting. So there are examples of both kinds. We need not get worried. Yes, all the positive changes will not take place shortly because people will take time to understand the new process, the new environment, and how to sort of go about business process re-engineering, whether it is for expansion or it is for redesign. So the short-term engagement concept is going to come into the sort of light much more. We will have to now look at the workforce, which is going to give real-time results. No more time will be given, long time will be given to the people who come in, that you can get 3 months, 6 months time to start showing results. Now companies are pressing that the day you hire a person, you need to sort of start showing results immediately. At the same time, the OJT is going to get reduced. The psychosocial support, we will need much more. The monitoring has to be by MBOs. And all these things are now going to come into place. We have to have sort of redefined practices, reoriented practices for the COVID prevention, as well as for COVID management and post-COVID management. The compensation for these periods, the larger company, they are not sort of affecting the employees much because talent retention, skill retention, people retention is going to be much, much, much serious today than it was earlier because of the shortage of manpower, the relevant manpower that you need today. I can quote an example of Maruti. Maruti has a total capacity of about 20,000 plus employees. They had only 4,000 employees on the permanent roles and nearly 16,000 as the outsourced temporary employees. Now, unfortunately, a very large number of these temporary employees, they have migrated. And today, Maruti is facing a serious problem of activating even a single assembly line immediately. This is going to take time. And here comes the new business. Instead of closing our minds, we have to start seeing as to how and what we can do. Here comes the new business of mobilizing the resource, mobilizing the human resource. There are 6-7 new companies which have suddenly come up in last 1 month who are now operating out of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Bengal, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh to mobilize the workforce for the large corporates who need the workforce. Because the local workforce is unable to perform the role which the migrant workforce was doing earlier. And this will remain. And therefore, on one hand, where the job shrinkage is taking place, on the other hand, the business process reorientation, new kind of startups, new kind of business is possible. And now, therefore, the need for new kind of leadership, which is more empathetic, which is more visionary, which is more supportive, and which is also at the same time result oriented, is coming up. Therefore, the HR will need to redefine the kind of leadership that it requires, reskill, upskill, re-engage, or recruit new leaderships, which will be able to fit this new role. And we have to have a very clear vision for both in domestic as well as extension. And we have to have very clear plans and contingencies. We have to be ready to face a larger amount of scrutiny by the finance. Every single activity of the company today, of every organization, is going to come under a larger, greater, deeper scrutiny by the finance, because cost cutting has become very, very essential. The need management will have to sort of be very focused. A skilling strategy has to be in place. A very, very relevant, time relevant and time critical skilling strategy has to be in place. We have to define our skill sets much more clearly than what we've been saying. We need the right fit. We've been saying this for a long time, but we are not doing it all this time. But now this need for this is much greater than it was earlier. Getting pre-skilled employees is need of the hour, but not everywhere will we be able to get the pre-skilled people. Therefore, we'll have to see the aspect of skill addition. We will have to see the aspect of skill upgradation. We'll have to see the aspect of multi-skilling. And we'll also have to see the aspect of skill transition. All these things will have to be focused by the HR. All these practices we have to see, including the multi-skilling, so that the emergencies, so that the contingencies, and so that the absence can be managed. More than the skills, we have to focus on the knowledge also. We have to focus on the attitude and the behavior. Until and unless we are able to focus on the behavior and the productivity, we will be finding things difficult. On one hand, we are talking of trying to invite the foreign companies into India. But on the other hand, we are so far unable to compete with the Chinese manpower as far as the productivity is concerned. It is being said that the differential between the productivity of a Chinese worker and an Indian fellow is about 1:1.6. We need to assess this, whether it is true or otherwise. And wherever the gaps are there, wherever we can do enhancement of the productivity, we have to focus on that. And as far as the most important aspect is concerned, I'll say that we have to now start focusing much more on character. This is one aspect which I stress always, that this character is very, very important. It is not only important for the companies, it is important for the partners, it is important for the clients, it is important for the customers. On one hand. On the other hand, it is important because the employees also gain from it. And they gain because their own reputation, their own brand value is going to enhance if they are able to demonstrate the character qualities in much larger measure than what has been seen so far. The aspect of self-discipline will gain much more importance. We have to be very punctual, both for productivity and enhancement. We have to find the people who can assure commitment, involvement, the sharing, the performance, the initiative, the problem solving skills, and make it a habit of all these things. Not a one-time requirement, but making it a habit for all these things. And the most important aspect which is going to help each one of us is the time management. How we are able to create a very good strategy for time management and time management culture, and how we can reduce the slack time, reduction of slack time, optimizing of the work time, and adding value and recognition to the value of time. Once we start doing this, the productivity and other things are bound to improve. As far as performance is concerned, we will have to sort of define the standards and parameters in relation to the output, both quantitative and qualitative. We have to also address the aspects of value addition, the commitment, the cultural aspect of within the performance, and within the performance also start seeing the influencing environment, positive, the negative, and the wasteful. How does a person address these issues? We also have to focus on the self-development vis-a-vis the institutional development. The aspiration management will have to be sort of factored by the HR. Aspiration management at times could be realistic, at times it could be more than realistic. So that aspect we have to manage. As far as the cooperation is concerned, a 360-degree cooperation evaluation and assessment has become much more important. So in other words, if I may say, the bucket list is very, very large. The expectations are huge. At the same time, if you want to sort of train and retain this HR, the investment is huge. And if that is so, then the managing this HR becomes that much more critical, and therefore the value of every single HR manager is that much more now. Now the value of HR will have to actually go up compared to the operational managers or the financial managers or anybody else, because it is you who's going to affect the top line, bottom line, and all the lines that you normally refer to. The talent retention becomes much more important, because the selection cost, the induction cost, the training cost, retention cost, skilling cost are huge. So on one hand, there is a problem of attrition. If you are able to sort of retain them, well, good. A cost benefit mix we have to assure. I will say that the safety of the employee we have to ensure besides the training. The volume momentum have to be created once again. And it is not going to be a very, very easy task. People who have migrated, they are very, very apprehensive of re-lockdowns. They are apprehensive of the security of the job. They are apprehensive of the security of their workplace, the security, or rather their residential accommodation, their insurance, and all other things. All these things will have to be factored in case we have to get them back. So the short-term and the long-term strategies basically will have to be catered for depending on all these. I will very shortly mention that the DHL Freight Management focus their strategy on anticipation, protection, and communication. Coca-Cola was focused on information, support, and aid. Infosys was focused on well-being, continuity, and community action. Covestro of China was focused on timeliness, agility, and empowerment. And Takeda of Brazil was focused on understanding productivity and limiting of the stress. With all this, now I come to conclusion. And in conclusion, I'll say that our reorientation of the HR practices should focus on creating a HR good, vibrant HR strategy, which can give us relevant to the size of the company HR, which can give us HR which is affordable and yet has the aspect of excellence, a HR strategy which is well defined and gives out the HR needs much more specifically. It is fit to sustain the business. It is essential staff and succession come replacement planning is factored. The talent and skill retention is factored. The competitive aspect and the compensation benefits are taken care of. And it meets the needs of diversification and expansion where possible, and caters to the short-term and long-term needs both. This strategy, if we are able to create, we have some time and we are able to implement properly post COVID, this will give us much more advantages and benefits. And to conclude, I'll say that shashwat keval prakriti hai. शाश्वत केवल प्रकृति है, लेकिन प्रकृति भी बदलाव चाहती है, बदलाव करती है। दिन के बाद रात, रात के बाद दिन, गर्मी के बाद सर्दी, सर्दी के बाद गर्मी, और समय के साथ जो छाया वो भी घूमती है। हमको भी घूमना पड़ेगा, हमको बदलना पड़ेगा, आने वाली अपॉर्चुनिटीज को हमें देखना पड़ेगा। वी हैव टू सी द इमर्जिंग ह्यूज लार्ज नंबर ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज एंड HR इज वन space which will gain more prominence, which will create much larger value. These strategies and practices that you people have been creating earlier need to be refined, looked at with a different sort of view. I'm sure you all will do very well and work for a very bright future, although the intervening short period may be a slight difficulty. So I wish each one of you all the very best. I'm sorry if I've taken a little more time. Wish you all. No,
thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an insightful session. And you have talked so many important aspects of HR practices and measures which companies are already taking. And we can think upon what we can look forward regarding the new practices, because of course it's a test of human mind, how human mind can think of new strategies. You talked about a lot of important aspects, like crisis management teams have already been created by companies. This is a time for reskilling and reskilling. Employees have to think about their character, their actuality. Also, companies have to think about talent retention, diversification, and expansion. Thank you so much once again for these important points that you have raised. Of course, these conversations enable us to dwell upon new thoughts and work upon further. Thank you so much, sir. So next, I would now like to invite Sanjeev Kumarji to please share his views on the topic. Please, sir. Sanjeev, sir.
Thank you, Aparna. Let me thank Dr. Rajesh and GLA, Bajaj Institute and family for giving us this opportunity. General Saab has set the tone and he has possibly touched upon every aspect of HR and given a very macro view of the challenges that HR will be facing and is currently facing. I must add to that, in a world which is all we like to call as VUCA world, which is volatile, uncertain, and ambiguous. At the very outset, a very old conversation between an interviewer and Sadhguru, the famous Rishi and management guru, Sadhguru, had happened some time back, and it was related to one of the incidents that we had all seen on TV. It was about a difficult situation in our state of Jammu and Kashmir, where an army team was facing a lot of resistance in one of the areas, and they were up against a population which was resisting the armed forces, pelting stones, insulting them, calling out names, not allowing them to, and almost held the team as at ransom. Now, we had a team which was led by a young officer, Major Litul Gogoi, and he came up with a very controversial kind of a solution, but a solution which saved the day, for not only for the army team, but also it diffused the situation largely. What he did was evident on the TV. He had tied up a person right in front of an army vehicle, and he led his team out of that tricky situation where the lives of not only the armed forces people, but also of the civilians was at risk. Now, this situation was this, when this conversation between an interviewer and Sadhguru happened, this situation was presented to Sadhguru, and he was given a poser, what he would advise this young army officer, how he differently he could have handled it. a man as wise as Sadhguru, as we all know, without batting an eyelid, he said, who am I to advise this person what he should have done in that situation? In effect, what he said was, whatever we may do, however good we may train, however good fit a person we may try to find out, however good tools that we may like to provide to our team members, it is man in the moment, he takes a call. So HR always aspires to build an army of people who are thinking on their feet, they're up to the situation, and we all hope that they come out with flying colors in any kind of a situation. We are today, the HR communities today is again face to face with a humongous challenge, as Janu Saab has said. My own experience of all over 30 years and a lot of training programs that I have undergone, a lot of things that we have as a professional learned and unlearned, tells me and points me to one direction. As Janu Saab had rightly said, that we have been talking about a lot of things, possibly everything under the sun that HR should be doing has been under consideration, some being in focus, some being on the back burner, some being talked about, and some being formulated. But the most important thing for me is execution. You can have your plans, you can possibly have thought out every possible variables, every possible situation, but if you fail to execute your plans, the plan remains on a piece of paper. It helps nobody. And possibly because of that, Professor Ram Charan has written his book, Execution, only mentioning how to execute a plan. He believes, and I'm also a firm believer of his thought, that unless you put any plan that you have formulated into action, it remains a dead piece. It's only on paper. And no wonder some wise man has said that action speaks louder than words. The HR community has been working, and I would say like a computer which has got a back end and a front end. The front end is at the employee interface. He has employee engagement programs, performance management, outcome management, rewards management, well-being of the employee is a very umbrella and a universal concept. But what happens at the back end? What are we doing at the back end? Possibly what we have done in the last couple of years is put electronics to our processes, and we call them as digital process. This is our IT. When I was working for SR, a group as large as those days, it was almost 30,000 people. And we always had a very engaging conversation with our HR head, and sometimes we were inviting our business leaders. The expectations of the business leaders from HR was a set of myriad deliverables. They expected everything under the sun. So when we would debrief our own HR team, what were the things that we were actually looking at? So we were actually looking at a bucket list, the things to do, things that we want to do it now or possibly should have done yesterday. And I come back again, what are the things that HR practices that we need to see change? Any IT iteration that we adopt in any organization, I have noticed they centralize things much more than they decentralize. It is more of a control instrument rather than an empowering instrument. It is more of a process. It is more of a data gathering thing rather than empowering HR folks in any organization to take decisions where he should be taken. You don't have to tell a soldier on the border whether he needs to fire his rifle or he needs to duck. It is his training that makes an instinct out of him, out of his whole reaction. And the same thing that we need to do for our HR folks. I'm a great advocate of empowerment, and I believe that unless we allow our team members to make mistakes by taking decisions, they will make mistakes when they take decisions. Unless we empower them to take decisions, we are not going to get anywhere. So the first charter of my action plan, first item in my charter of action plan would be to train people to take decisions. Give them the delegation, give them the authority, give them the tool to decide what is best for the organization. This decision making cannot be monopolized or held back only by a few. The second thing which I possibly look at is what kind of digital tools are we providing to our team members? Does it liberate him or does it make him a prisoner of a process? Today, most of the things, you look at any software, and when it comes to implementation part, I have seen people customizing it in a way that approvals flow upwards and the work flows downwards. This cannot continue. Our practices must change. The decision making has to happen where rubber hits the road. Our junior members, if we insulate them from getting bloodied in the boxing ring, they will never become good boxers. While we have to be at the ringside to ensure their well-being, they have to fight in the ring. So I would possibly give them a tool, give them the support, which is much more than IT support alone. It is a management support. We have to back them when they're working. And this whole change of mindset is possibly the biggest stumbling block that we need to address. Letting go of your own decision-making authority is possibly the biggest challenge I've ever come across in my, say, over 32 years of experience. We need to actually start at the top rather than at the bottom of the pyramid. We need to tell our leaders how they are going to delegate the power that they wield. Responsibility has been delegated long back. And while we are at an inflection point with this crisis staring the country, we need to tell them, this is the time you have to bring about a metamorphosis in your metamorphosis in your thinking. If at all we have to make an opportunity out of this crisis. I have been witness to the earthquake of 2001, when a whole city of Bhuj was decimated, and then we had sent our teams with all kinds of emergency equipments and all kinds of tools and JCBs to remove the rubble. We realized that while this is a tragedy of Himalayan proportions, this is also an opportunity to rebuild a whole city. And that's what Bhuj today stands as an example, how we can convert a crisis into an opportunity. General Saab has said a lot of things about the opportunities that are available knocking at our door. One of the things that possibly in any organization I would like to do is panic management. A lot of organizations are getting into a knee-jerk reaction of slashing the workforce, holding back the bonuses, holding back the payments, deferring promotions, deferring increments, downsizing, and doing all kinds of things. But I've come across only a handful of organizations, and I'm not shy away from naming them, one such organization is Asian Paints, which decided and took a call that they will not defer any of their reward programs. They have gone ahead with their promotions. They have gone ahead with their increments. They have gone ahead with their performance bonuses. I think this is the first real hurdle that any business needs to overcome. And if at all they have to take a hard decision of deferring things, they have to take the employee into confidence. Now, regardless of whatever we may say about technology, work from home, redesigning our workplaces, human beings essentially are social beings. One of the great thinkers had said that human being is a social animal. I will not say that human beings are animals, but they are social beings. Try as we might, whatever we may do, unless we interact face to face, there is going to be a missing piece of the puzzle, which will make it always incomplete. In one of the programs that I attended at Harvard, Professor Boris Goresberg was there, and I posed a question: why don't you put all your content on online, and we will do our pre-program study and come back well prepared. And he was very candid when he replied to me. He said, "We have done that experiment, and we have realized that this is one of the tools which is only partly successful." And we were discussing a very popular case of Chobani yogurt, which was possibly one of the largest selling yogurt in America. And we were shown a lot of videos and everything about this whole thing. But when people from Chobani were invited for an interaction with us, their head of HR and director of HR both came to our classroom. And when we bombarded them with all kinds of questions, I realized that a face-to-face interaction has got no substitute. Online classes, online trainings, online meetings, they're all right. I'm not discouraging in any way. They certainly have their purpose, and they're serving their purpose quite well. But HR fraternity has to address the situation. How are we going to interact with our own people? It cannot be impersonal. Unless you have a touch and feel kind of a interaction with your own employees, I think an organization becomes quite dehumanized. And that kind of an organization will never survive. So this is one of the agenda which we have to work on. And I believe that our behavioral changes, our concern for our co-worker, our concern for our family, our concern for our co-worker's family is equally important. How we are going to touch their lives is something that I have not been able to unravel so far. But I believe that a personal connect, a personal touch, a visit to their homes or to them will possibly be more productive than any amount of online interaction. One of the items on my bucket list will be taking a re-look at the IT support that HR currently has. We believe that we work through emails, but my personal view is that email is a great productivity destroyer. We have not got out of the mindset that we create evidence, we create proof via emails that we are doing our best. This has to change. Possibly the workplace also has to get redesigned. How we are going to do it is something that we need to put our heads together. And possibly a session of this can at best, we can list out the items that we need to look at. Solutions will come in coming days. Behavioral changes have to be institutionalized in each of us. We cannot work the way we're working in pre-COVID days. We have to rethink about each and every practice, how our workplace has to be designed, how our policies for work from home has to be designed, how our healthcare policies have to be reworked for our own people, and how we as an organization can provide assurances, assurance of all kind, whether it is job security, whether it is career advancement, whether it is assessment of people, all kinds of things that we need to really work at. So I'll possibly look at IT infra, IT support, delegation matrix, behavioral adaptation, arming our people with digital tools and empowerment. These are the things that I'll be possibly focusing on in the coming days that will possibly not be way of the mark. At the end of the day, all our empowerment, training, respect, tools that we have will boil down to what kind of people we have been able to really make out of our own employees. It is at the end of the day, we are very proud of our Indian Army, but our Indian Army also has one of the highest rates of officers getting martyred in any conflict. And that happens only because our officers lead from the front. They don't allow their other ranks or the JCOs to go ahead of them. They are the flag bearers. And this is what HR people have to do at this point of time. Opportunities, this is a crisis. And the crisis has to be turned into an opportunity, as Roosevelt did during his tenure from 1933 to 1945. The Great Depression was, despite all the stimulation packages that US government had come about, was not helping. So what he did was, what he understood very clearly was that he will have to do something different. And the opportunity was presented to the world after the Second World War. So the crisis that we are today will blow over in few days, and the opportunities that this crisis would have presented, we have to grab it with our both hands. This kind of an opportunity doesn't come in a millennium. So let's get down with our bucket list. Let us formulate our plans and execute them well. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Lots of pertinent points you have discussed. And of course, executing the plan is, of course, more important than only we can see some outcomes. Thank you so much for sharing name of Ram Charan Ji. I hope I'm correct. Ram Charan Ji, the book. Yeah. Thank you so much. I'll definitely read it out. And you talked a very important issue that employee empowerment is so important with the example of soldier and modern job example. Also, you talked about training people to take decision. Of course, we need to train people for employee empowerment. Panic management, one of the most important aspect that we are experiencing as an employee or others also, they are experiencing a lot of stress are going around due to this pandemic effect. And also, you talked about the employee experience, and you're a great supporter of digital tools and technology that you would recommend all the organization to equip your employee with all these IT technologies and digital support. Thank you so much once again for all the important aspects that you talked about. Now, I would request Dilip Sinha ji to please enlighten us with your valuable thoughts on this topic. May I request Dilip Sinha ji?
Dilip is there?
Dilip Sinha is there. I think he's muted.
Yeah, it is muted by your IT, so I couldn't do it.
Oh, sorry.
Please continue, sir. We apologize.
Okay, everything started on 22nd of March with the first Janta curfew, and the situation changed. The new normal has come. 23rd, the Prime Minister addressed the nation, and the problem began in the country. 24th morning, we had around 50,000 people working across. Out of that, all essential people ran off on 24th. The drivers, the housekeeping. People were very vulnerable to those announcements. They got panicked, they ran away. My biggest challenge was there were 20,000 people inside the plant. Drop them home, bring the another reliever. It's not easy to contain 20,000 people inside who are already working from 8 hours. Anyway, we convinced people to stay back for another shift. We promised that within 8 hours we will strike this, we will decide the strategy and go ahead. We had an emergency meeting. We were 10 people. The top management was with us. So after mulling of 3-4 hours, completely studying everything, we said, it was my idea only, that let's go for 12-hour shift. That's the only solution for having minimum people inside. Minimum burden on the canteen, minimum burden on your infrastructure, more turnaround time for buses, etc., all these things. It's not a surprise. Out of 10, it is illegal to meet the last duty. But chairman was very firm. He asked me only one question. Dilip, are you confident we can run 12 hours a day? I said, yes. He said, go ahead. 12 hours working, next day holiday. 12 hours working, again next day holiday. So, you work 8 hours in a week. Every one day holiday. Fantastic work-life balance. I think it's challengeable. I can wield that force to fight out with the court also. No issues. Went ahead, you'll be surprised. I wrote to the director industry and labor commission that we are going to the lawsuit considering this national emergency kind of situation. Second day, he replied, wonderful initiative. Go ahead, let us know what else you are doing. And you all know that 2 months back, this has become a policy. So I can claim that to a last shift in India, I have started. First time in India to a last shift legally claim, I have started. See, the interesting part is that, especially the young forces listening to us, our laws and factories act, option establishment, all the laws are wonderful. You need to find out the ways how to implement. The law talks about 12 hours. I just invoked that. People are afraid. What will happen? See, our mindset is like this. So this is one example I am giving. Now, the entire India is following 12-hour shift and managing their concentration inside the plant or office work space, right? So, as a whole, now I'll come to the macro level. How I saw, and the company also saw, on four macro level aspects, which is first of all, think that this is new normal, nothing has changed except the disease. Earlier also cost rationalization was there, more productivity was there, maximum margin was there, nothing has changed. The way we work has changed that. You need to regulate in a new manner. So it has affected basically, areas, process, technology, and the ecosystem. So people aspect, if you see, new regulations, your HR policy has become redundant. You need to redefine, keep on redefining, adjusting to the situation, work-life balance, work hours, facilities, medical care, family care, all these things will come in. The second aspect in people, hiring part. Hiring is going on. I've hired maximum number of people this time. There are more than 600 management trainees with us who are joining in batches. Of course, the mode of joining has changed, right? So I'll just touch upon one or two points so that I can inculcate some spark in the young brains who are listening to us. To HR should work radically, not follow the blue book of the rules. Then only the time to come, they will get the success. Otherwise, they'll fail, okay? The process part, of course, more and more technology, more electronics, use of your use in your day-to-day life. Technology has completely changed. You have online tests, you have online interviews, meetings, office space. One more example I will give you here. A lot of articles are coming on social distancing, this, that, all, again, go back to Factories Act or Shops and Establishment Act, which are the source for manufacturing and non-manufacturing operation. It defines what kind of space you need to work. If you follow that, you are through with social distancing. You don't need to redefine. Please don't follow your WhatsApp university. Follow your rule books. You will find all the answers. Just follow it, you will be successful. The third and the most important part was ecosystem for us. When you do everything, the ecosystem opposes you. All our plants and operations are situated outskirts, obviously. So when the government allowed, see, we have not stopped even a day because we were essential service. So we just bloat down to a minimum level for 2 days on the 23rd of March. And then again, within 15 days, we were back to 94% production. We are currently running 94 plus, right? So ecosystem had a major role to play. All the villages, your surroundings, your neighborhood, they started opposing. Opposing was very natural. They said, we are located in Bombay and Bangalore. Our two big plants are situated, both put together around 17 million ton, three times larger than Tata. We are largest integrated steel industry. Okay. So all the villagers said, no, your people are coming from, they are bringing COVID inside the plant. And since 70% workforce is from local area, they'll get infected. It was a real question, real concern for us also. So we said, fine, let us have a trade-off. We will not call people from Bombay or from Bangalore. We will keep them inside the plant or surrounding the plant. You support with your plant. They agreed. Kept entire force, critical force, of course, we decided who to come. And we kept the critical force almost for 2 months in nearby hotels or the guest house, following all the norms. We continued the operation. Again, I'm insisting, it's a new normal with a new way of work, nothing else. If you see the problem will come. If you see it as a positive way, it will come as a positive action, which will facilitate. And of course, this disease has given us a chance to streamline to the last. There's lesser time for a strategy, more time for execution. The execution is the key, of course, what Sanjeev said, execution is the key. You have to do execution on, I call it regimental execution. You don't have chance to fail. You have to succeed, right? So these were basically four areas which we followed. We made the SOP for operating inside the plant, outside the plant, traveling, everything we made within 1 week in the plant. We did not speak much. We did not have any media to show, but we operated in this manner. And I tell you, just for a week, we were 70% of production. Now we are running. After that day, we are running on 92%. Think radically. Make use of the existing system. Don't try to change everything. Be radical. Sources available. Interpret it well. You will have success. Thank you very much.
Good.
Yeah. So Chris, and so to the point session you have already delivered, sir, new process it is. Of course, we need to realize and we don't have to be scared so much about what happened again. And we have to, of course, to think radically. Congratulations, first of all, for running the company and your whole department so successfully in this pandemic itself, where small companies and many various companies have, they just broke out with in this pandemic and in this crisis. Redefining yes. HR policies is one of the important aspects. Technology support, yes, you talked about very well. And ecosystem, we have to recognize the ecosystem and we have to accordingly work and re-strategize our whole process, not to again be scared about the different things. Thank you so much once again. Very practical insights you have shared. Thank you so much. So now I would request Rakesh Sethji to please, sir, deliver your session on the topic.
Thank you very much. At the outset, I would like to convey my thanks to Dr. Ajay for inviting me to speak at this platform, and also Professor Arpana Kumari for introducing me. So, you know, after listening to Major General Dilawar Singh Ji and Sanjeev Kumar and Dilip, all have, you know, very nicely presented their viewpoint. In fact, Major General Dilawar Singh, he has already reviewed a human resource management book, you know, what it contains. He has talked about everything. And Sanjeev talked about the other part very nicely, that is the execution side of it. And Dilip Sinhaji took us to the largest plant, and they said that during these tough times also, they continue to run the plant despite all the problems and the objections from the local people, and how nicely they organized themselves to ensure that their plant should continue to run and should be running at the capacity, which he talked about, from 70% currently runs at 94%. That's a commendable job, and that's real HR in my view. So what I'll do is I'll confine myself around the HR. So we have talked about, and we know that every day, you know, these are unprecedented times, of course, and every day we listen to some news where number of people are being reduced and the offices are being shut. You know, while we were chatting and we saw a news clipping of Uber is closing down their Mumbai offices. So you can imagine what's going on in the marketplace. So there are departures taking place, there are inductions taking place. So in light of this, the you know, entire burden gets onto the HR. So therefore, I say that in today's world, HR is the most engaged function, you say. And after CEO, the most busiest person, and the person who is taking all the responsibility is the CHRO of the organizations. And some of the CHROs have done a commendable job of running their businesses well, like Mr. Dilip Sinha has done a commendable job as a CHRO of JSW and ensuring that plants in these two best locations are ran successfully. So my point is that what HR currently doing is and engaged is in the redesigning of the workplace and the layouts. As Major General said, that many companies are now, you know, discarding their offices. They want their people to work from home. That's a new normal. It was not there. And this is what we'll call for a reorientation of HR. Now, reorientation of HR will happen if the reorientation of business is happening, reorientation of the processes is happening. And that's very much happening in the workplace and also in the marketplace that we see. So we also see the remote working, work from home, you know, and once you have a work from home, you have to redesign the policies. So that has also been talked about. And the employee-related compliances, that will increase sharply at the workplace, you know, in terms of social distancing, in terms of sanitization at the workplace, in terms of masking at the workplace, in terms of ensuring the, you know, new hygiene standards at the workplace. So these are the changes that has, you know, and the reorientation the HR will have to do, you see, one. And thirdly is the employee morale. So what's happening on the employee morale, that the organization will have to ensure that the fears from the minds of the people is removed, you know. That's what the challenge for the organization is. People are coming to the offices, but they come to the office with a fear that it should not happen, they get attracted to COVID or something happens to them, you see. So there's an element of fear. And second change is the daily health checkup, you know. So when they come on the gate and somebody puts a, you know, thermometer to check the temperature of your body, and that's a new thing, you know. And you can imagine there is an element of fear in the minds of a person who is being screened, you know. So that's another challenge. And it is happening every day. It is not that it is happening once in 2 days or 3 days, but it's happening every day. So therefore, the challenge is, how do you invite people to the organization and how do you motivate them so that they concentrate only on the work that they need to deliver? So that's the change in my view, you know, the organization will have to do. So many of the things that have been covered by my previous speakers. So what I see that how the reorientation of HR will take place in the future, you know. The reorientation of HR will take place around the four buckets in my view. So there will be one bucket which will talk about the strategic side of the HR, which deals with organization developments, which deals with the planning and implementation at the workplace, change management, strategic human resource management, redesigning the organization in light of the remote working and also the work from office scenarios, okay? Understand the dynamics over the virtual environment. When I say dynamics, it is in terms of communication and in terms of conflict. How will you resolve conflicts in a virtual situation? Because at the face-to-face environment, you know, there is a face-to-face talk and you confront and you try and resolve it. But how will you do it in a virtual environment? That's the another challenge that we'll face. You know, talent design and talent positioning. Once you have about 40 to 50% of the people working from the home, how will you ensure that they are getting developed? You know, people get developed when they work under somebody, you know, and when they are in the fields. And if people are working from the home, so how will you design and help them that they get a confidence, they get a responsibility, and they, you know, their man-management skills improve? So I believe that the challenge for people will be to improve their man-management skills in a virtual environment, you know. So that's the strategic side of the business and the reorientation, you know, that the HR will have to do. And second, lastly, the coaching, you know. The face-to-face coaching will not take place at least till November, but coaching in a virtual environment, how will you do the, you know, coaching in a virtual environment to keep people under check? I find that people who are more successful, you will have to do a coaching for them as compared to the people who are not so successful, you see. Because successful people will continue to look for a kudos every day. So how do you give kudos to every day to the people who are successful at the workplace? So that's a challenge in my view that will happen. So these are the strategic side of the organization development. This is the one bucket. Now the second bucket of the reorientation of HR, I would say that the entire stuff has moved into a HR technology area. You know, the fastest thing that has happened in the organization is the digitization. The speed with which the COVID has spread, with the same speed the, you know, the digitization has spread in the organization. All organizations today online, all organizations are on the Zoom, all organizations are doing their meetings on the virtual platform. So that's a big change that has happened. And the entire HR, therefore, is working on the you know, platform. So the, what it means that your recruitment, all processes in terms of recruitment, in terms of selection, on, as we talked about, online interview, online testing, even the CHROs today are being hired based on the telephonic interviews. You know, it never happened earlier. This has happened now. This is a new change. You know, people have accepted that the virtual environment is acceptable norm. You see, it is not that something you need to see a person, you know, physically to establish that the person is right. So there is a dependence on the, you know, recruitment consultant who is proposing the candidates to ensure that the candidate is physically fit. And it is the responsibility of the organizations and the interviewer to see that they have developed those kind of competencies in interviewing, that they are able to select CEOs, CFOs, and also the junior level people on the you know, online recruitment selection boards. Then the onboarding has also moved into it, you know, a virtual mode. Virtual training, we have seen webinar is the new normal. Every day you have a webinar going on. It starts in the morning at 10:30 and goes on till 8:30 in the night. So it has never happened that the training has happened in the organizations or to an individual at such a speed. So this is the reorientation, I believe, that has happened. See, even the schools are being run on online, you see. And the young students, as young as a 7 years kid also is sitting in front of the screen and listening. So that's a new orientation that is happening in the societies, you see, which was not there earlier. And the performance management is also being done online. You know, people who are operating from the home, they are being tested, they are being asked to upload their work on the sites through the various, you know, apps that are there in the marketplace. So what's happening, it is not that face-to-face, but the virtual and the technology has become an intrinsic part of the organization running. Payroll administration is happening online and your salaries are getting transferred to you on the, you know, 4th or 5th of every month. You know, even if you're working from home and you get a salary, so that is acceptable norms. You know, that's where the reorientation of HR has to take place, you know, in the future also. Because earlier people used to say that person has not come to the office. If he has not come to the office, he won't be paid. So you have a scenario where the 30 days the person is not coming to the office, operating from the home, and that's where you have to pay him after 30 days the kind of a work that he has delivered, whether he has worked 4 hours, 5 hours a day, 3 hours a day, but you pay him for all 8 hours. So that's a new change that has happened, you know. So what is happening that we are moving from 8 hours clerical working over 4 hours, you know, real intellectual working. If you are even working for 4 hours and delivering results, and companies are accepting that what you are doing is really outcome based and helping organizations in improving their business results. So organizations are paying to the people their salaries. They are not looking at whether you are 8 hours or 4 hours types, but what work you deliver. That's a new orientation in HR, in my view, that will happen. That's taking place. Employee engagement activities are also happening through the online platform. So that's another reorientation in my view, you see. So there's a second bucket. This is the second bucket which I talked about. One is the organizational development bucket. That's the strategic side of it. HR technology, which is driven by all the HR processes. This is the technical side of it, and the technical side of HR that will get reoriented in my view. And the third bucket is that of a employee relations. So this is how the industrial relations will get reoriented as a employee relations in the times to come in a post-COVID environment, you know. And that's where the employment compliances will happen. And today you can imagine people are not going to the offices, but yet all the compliances are happening on the online. So what it means that all businesses today are happening online. You see, the employment compliances will happen online. The social behavior of the people will also undergo a change. Distances, communication, relationships, communication, employment grievances. So they are all going to get, you know, resolved through the process of the employee relations bucket. And relationship with the unions also, you know, the HR guy is not going to come every day to talk to the union president, but he is also going to talk to the union presidents or the union, people through the online environment. So that's the change that has happened, you know, that how well you communicate with them over the virtual environments to keep them engaged and ensure that they contribute to the business effectively. So that's these are the three buckets in my view which will get reoriented in a post-COVID scenario. Now the fourth bucket, which I say is unfortunately this is also not taught in the business schools, and people are also not trained in that way in this environment. And we have also, my previous speakers have also not touched upon this area. And this I personally feel that the HR guy in the post-COVID environment will have to imbibe into its personality. Because, historically we have seen HR is a internal functions, you know, they work inside the organizations. When they work inside the organization, they are only talking about the stakeholders inside the organization. Here I'm talking about the HR has to handle the external stakeholders effectively, you see. So the external stakeholders typically are your universities, institutes, employer associations, government agencies, communities development programs, reviewing the external environment continuously to protect your organization. So what it means that the new HR will have to have a great deal of public relations skills. Their ability to deal with the deputy commissioner level people, their ability to deal with the commissioner level people, their ability to deal with the senior officials of the government to ensure that the all compliances are met, sanctions are taken from time to time, interactions are made to ensure that they are running a business which is free from all the hassles which the government has laid down for them in terms of the compliances. So that's the public relation skill that the new HR guy will have to imbibe. I've been told that today when the CHRO in large plants, the key skill which they look for is the ability to interact with the public departments, the ability to deal with the external agencies effectively, internal as well as external stakeholders effectively. So that's my fourth bucket, which I say, this is the fourth bucket, which is new bucket, which has not been talked about as of now in many of these, books. This is based on the research, and this is after having spoken to about 20 CHROs that what are the skills that they think that they need to refine in a post-COVID-19 environment or during the COVID-19 environment. And they say it is your ability to deal with the external agencies, like communities, especially communities and the government officials. So these are the four buckets, I think, that which will define the new orientation of HR. In my view, there could be many, but these are the four I find. And lastly, fifth one is that in the years to come or in the times ahead, the businesses will become business light. Okay, when I say business light, L-I-T-E, it means that they will become light in terms of assets. Now, light in terms of assets, in terms of offices, they will shrink their offices, they will shrink their manpower, and they will shrink their spaces, you see. they, instead of having a 1 lakh square foot area, they'll say, we don't need this much of area, because most of the guys are going to operate from home. They can operate from anywhere. The remote working is permissible. They are linked, over the, platform. So why should we have so many, square foot areas and pay unnecessarily rents? So that's the change that is happening, in my view, in the years to come. And another one is that the companies are becoming more interactive. They are becoming interactive with their employees on a day-to-day basis, and they are becoming more technology-driven, and they are becoming, lastly, high on energy. They want their guys to be agile. They want their guys to be energetic, and they want their employees to be fit at all points in time to ensure that the companies in today's environment are run with the highest hygiene standards. That's the one part, The companies are looking today at the highest hygiene standards, sanitized workplace, where everybody can enter and stay without fear. Even a CEO of the company can come without fear to the workplace. That's the kind of a hygiene standards that the companies are today talking about. And the distancing is the another challenge, you see. So these are some of the points, in my view, which will lead to the reorientation of HR in a post-COVID-19 environment, and that this is how the HR will get reshaped. It won't be a scenario where you will move into a face-to-face environment. I think the virtual environment will be accepted norms. Even if the person doesn't come to the office, he says, okay, let's get connected with him over the platform and talk to him and sort it out. Now the companies are not going to get into a situation where they will say, oh, let that guy come tomorrow and we will discuss it tomorrow. So it will not happen, So it will happen only that let's have him on the platform. Even if he's not there, let's have him on the platform to discuss and sort out the problem. So that's the change, in my view, that will happen. And that's the mindset that will happen. So that's where I will take a pause and hand over to Dr. Ajay. Back to you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Very pertinent points you have discussed. Of course, elements of fear and challenges are there. We have to overcome all these with our own strategies, motivating our people to keep contributing, and reorientation of HR with discussion on 5 buckets: strategic side of HR, HR technology, employee relations, skills and ability to deal with external agency should be adopted now, and employees need to be agile and fit. Thank you so much with all these 5 buckets that you talked about. And here we are done with all the speaker session. Thank you so much, everyone, for the wonderful session and excellent session. Before we sum up, I would like to take a few queries, because a lot of queries are there, I can see in the chat box. First query, and a lot of queries are related basically regarding the migrant workers. And the queries came for Major General Dilawar Singh Ji, that what could have been the strategies or the policies, what could we would have done not to see this scenario, because maybe in coming time, if we again face such challenges, what could happen now?
Thank you, Arpana. I had taken the initiative to study this phenomena before it took place, or rather when it was just about taking place. In fact, I have written a detailed article. I'll put it into some of the comment box or something if I can, wherein I had said that this kind of migration is likely to take place due to ABC reasons. And we need to evolve a strategy at the level of both the employer and the government, because both are stakeholders. And this complete paper, I had sent it to different people. Some people did take action on certain points. Some people did not see logic at that point in time, and they missed the bus. You see, it was not very difficult. Can we request people to just mute their mic, please?
May I request the host, please mute the mic?
Just mute the mic for a little while. Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much. Right. So this kind of situation has taken place now. Hopefully, it will not take place hereafter. Because now everybody has become conscious. Systems, institutions, and policies are now being placed by the governments and by the employers. They've realized now what has happened. As I mentioned to you about Maruti, Maruti was a bigger example. Take a very small example of an advertisement agency who had just about 15 people working with them. Now all 15 have gone. Now this person is unable to do a single work today because he did not take care of his work staff at the relevant period. Those very people who, for whatever reason, were not able to make payment for 2 or 3 months are now being compelled by this situation to spend more money in getting the people back. Firstly, they are paying airfares. Secondly, they are paying at least 2 months of advance pay to them. Thirdly, now companies are making arrangement for the accommodation near the workplace. Then, in addition to that, they are making sort of nice, decent arrangements for meals within the workplace. They are also arranging for medicines and groceries within the workplace so that after going out of the workplace, they don't have to go to contaminated areas to get them. And from there, they can go directly to their place of stay and get back. So, if we do not want to see this kind of thing in future, I don't think much will have to be done. People have already come to a realization because the cost-benefit analysis itself will indicate that retaining them was a better option, even though it would have amounted to spending maybe a month or a month plus worth of compensation in addition to what they would have got otherwise. It had certain amount of political overtones. Those political overtones are also being taken care of to some degree. 100% taking care of those political overtones is not possible because of the kind of political environment that we have. Thank you.
Can I answer this supplement, Major General?
Please. Sir, please.
We have 17,000 people that time when all it started as a political move that this migrant labor were moving to their hometown, right? These 17,000 people in Bangalore and Mumbai, they were staying in the labor colonies. You will be surprised, none of us left. We completely locked their gate. We provided them 100% salary, food, medicine, doctor, everything inside. Still they are working. You have to prevent the situation. Preempt.
You see, Sinha-san, if you execute, it will happen. You are lucky because you come from a very large family.
No. It's not luck.
Many others felt otherwise.
No, it's not luck. I got the collector also to the place to address them. These guys understand some languages. So I got the local collectors, a very good lady collector we have here. She came and addressed in the labor colonies, and we assured nothing will happen to you. We are here to pay.
You see, most of the companies
did not do this. That is why they lost them.
You've done a wonderful thing, no doubt about it. Similarly, Tata, similarly, some other companies like Asian Paints was mentioned. Some companies did take care, and those companies now are not in difficulty.
They have not faced any problems. Yeah,
those who did not, they have realized and taken their lessons. I'm sure next time they'll be careful.
It's all common sense. Again, I say be radical, take action. Yeah.
We all have to be there and to be together in this crisis, and then only, of course, we need to handhold those who are not able to cope up with the situation. Thank you so much for taking the query. Next important issue that is arising again related to, though companies are facing a lot of difficult time regarding revenue generation, and that's why companies are not holding their workforce. People are being fired. So what should be the strategy? And moreover, from both the perspective, I want to understand from employer side as well as from the employee side. If in case they are in this crisis and they think that they might be fired, then what should be their skill enhancement strategy? And if in case they are already being fired, then what should be their further strategy for getting the employment again for their family and rest of the things? So from both the perspective, would like to understand it from Dilip sir and then from Sanjeev sir also.
Okay. See, the major outfall of this pandemic is definitely visible in air, travel industry, automobile industry, retail industry, and hospitality industry. This will happen and this will continue. These four industries will bounce back. It will take longer period. Core industries already bounced back. Steel, infrastructure, cement, these have already come back on the track. So the natural fallback of these four industries, nobody can help. I mean, there's no demand, there's no work, there's no product need. So this will we have to bear with this. Economy passes through. It's all cyclical. The economy is passing through a different phase. Only we have to wait, see them bouncing back, and again, coming to the normal. But till then, I don't know. I don't have any answer how to hold the workforce still with you, especially smaller company, MSME and below company. They will find it difficult, especially this fall.
Exactly. And suggestion for employees and, of course, for the new freshers also, because a lot of the students have also joined. How they can cope up and they can survive.
Sorry, I couldn't get in these industries or you're talking
in, yeah, in these industries where there are chances of more firings.
Yes.
Boys understand.
There is a prediction of all the big four consultants. There will be around 52% job loss. So almost industry will lose 50% of the jobs. This will give opportunity to work as an expert. I mean, a gig force will work out of consultancy. They can work. System will find some opportunities. That's the natural outcome of this can happen until they have to wait for the business to come back. There's no choice. It's the worst time we are facing through.
It's more of a time of sort, understanding your strength and accordingly building it up. Thank you so much, Dilip sir. Sanjeev sir would like to understand your views also on this pertinent question.
My thoughts are also quite similar to what Dilip has just said. I believe this is a black swan event. We are passing through a grave and a great crisis. And some of the industries will get badly hurt. Like, as you said, travel, hotel, airlines, these are the industries. While everybody is predicting a very grim scenario of job losses, we have to go back to our business leaders and we have to tell them that they have to come out of this whole mindset of looking at margins, and they have to look at the most precious resource that which they have is human resource. Largely, the reaction in the country has been of a panic and a fear, and that has been people have not been able to really decipher the advice from the government. When the first exodus of migrant labor happened from the cities like Bombay, Bangalore, some cities in Gujarat and other places, while the government has been stressing that wherever you are, please stay. And as Mr. Saif rightly said, and I think General Saab also said that industries are incurring even steep cost, higher than what they could have possibly had they managed their migrant labor much better than what they did actually. The cost that which they are incurring today is much higher. From the migrant population also, there is a greater realization that the panic which forced them to walk back to some of the nearby locations or take trains or take whatever means to go back to their hometowns has not really helped them. Because whatever money which they had, whatever small savings they had, was spent on going back to their hometowns, which offered only a certain level of comfort. I can state for one of the states of in Bihar, government of Bihar had come up with almost 10,000 quarantine facilities, and I know for a fact that how well these facilities were managed, because in my own village, our school was converted into a quarantine facility. And it was hardly a week's time when people started realizing that they had come to their respective states out of fear rather than anything else. And today, look at the trains which are coming back from these states. They are fully packed. The migrant labor is coming back. The migrant situation is not something new that this government has faced. If you look at the Migrant Labor Act, which was formulated sometime in 1979, the situation was well read by government in those days, almost 40 years back. But the panic that had set in was largely because the assurance which was expected from their employers, from the local government, was missing. And this is the lesson that the country has learned, how to manage it better in case a similar situation repeats itself. Recovery is not going to be a weaker recovery. It is going to be possibly a very plateaued kind of a curve which will happen. It is going to be gradual. Liquidity is being pumped in. MSME, which had almost come to a standstill because the migrant labor had vanished completely, they are now gradually restarting their engines. But I agree with Dilip that this recovery will be slow. I see within a year things coming back to the normal, because if you look at some of the consumption figures, the power offtake is already 89% of the pre-COVID levels, and the construction activity, road construction activity, bridges, infrastructure construction activity, which has been carried on, has again picked up. People want jobs, people want resources to sustain themselves, and there is a greater appetite for taking the risk. Recovery rates, the higher recovery rates has possibly addressed the fear which migrant labor had, and even better recovery rate will give them the assurance that this disease is, while it is highly contagious and infectious, the fertility rate, this disease can be defeated. So fertility rates are less, and with some of the medicines which are being offered now, will give greater comfort and confidence to people to come back to work. But yes, next 12 months are going to be difficult, but we are on the way to recover our lost ground. That's all I feel.
Thank you so much. Last question I would like to take, and would like to ask from Rakesh. Sir, you are a motivational speaker. So, employee experience you talked about. So, how companies are ensuring a better employee experience and motivating their employee in this pandemic? A lot of stress is already around.
See, of course, there are many things which are happening, but I will talk about something new which is going to happen, and the organization will change their mindset also. And that mindset is, you know, they are allowing their employee, they will have to allow their employee to work from home, to work for multiple employers. If they have, you know, they can work for one employer, they can work for another employer if they get the job from somewhere else. So this is a new phenomena, in my view, that will happen. And that will motivate people. People get motivated not so much by money. People get motivated by money on a short-term basis, and it is applicable in a scenario where the person is operating from a basic level. But today, when you have an educated workforce, they get motivated more by the work. So this is what I always say, that the employer must ensure that each and every person who is employed organization should be given some kind of a work to do, so that he should be, you know, felt that he is part of the organization. Because today, you know, everybody has to work from home or everybody has to be away. I'm talking about current scenario. So the way to motivate is give them work, you know, involve them, have with them a Zoom meetings, you know, involve everyone on Zoom meetings, start some clubs where they can come and contribute and share their thoughts, you know. Run a lot of round tables, you know. We run a round table in ICPI every week, you know. The whole idea is that, you know, people want to speak. Now, we are there four speakers, so we are speaking. But if they're given a chance, everybody would like to speak. And when everybody speaks, they feel motivated, you know. So this is where the organizations are now going through a scenario that, you know, they are holding a lot of Zoom sessions. They are telling their employees to send us videos, and videos get uploaded so that they are visible on various platforms. So this is the way to motivate people. Money is important, you know. Employees to a very large extent understand that if my factory is closed, my office is closed, there are no earnings, how will I get the money, you see? Now, nobody is going to pay out of his pocket. Out of his pocket, he can pay for 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, depending on each one's own capacity to pay. But motivation comes when you involve people, when you talk to them, you know, you create a sense of belongingness. You also give them assurances, give them 50% of the salaries, 40% of the salaries, but keep giving them, you know, or something or the other. And work is very important, in my view, to motivate them. Talking to them is a motivation.
Very true. So that's how we got this term employee engagement, and nowadays we call it employee experience. Thank you so much, all the speakers, for this insightful session. And so many information we have received, so many understanding about HR practices and measures we have received from such a important position you people are already holding and you've already held. So now I would really we basically understood the realistic view of the scenario and what recommended solution that we can look forward with to minimize the adverse effect of crisis on business outcomes and employees. With these words, I would request our director, Dr. Ajay Kumar sir, to please proceed with the concluding remarks.
Wonderful deliberation by all the speakers, all the esteemed guests. I extend my gratitude to all of you for not only highlighting the theoretical aspects of the things, I mean, those things which were told by our policymakers or by company executives, but categorically, if I remark, Dilip has done a wonderful job, and that has led to one very clear examples for all that if you plan and if you are positive and if you have the guts also, I would like to say guts also, and if you want to re-challenge the challenging things which is written on record, that is law, then things can be managed in a better way and organization can sustain, at least can sustain. But there were, as remarked by again, Dilip and Sanjeev both, there are several industries, several areas where such practices couldn't be implemented. We forgot about one industry, construction. It has been ruined. So challenges are manifold. Yes, we need to recalibrate the work and the workforce. It remains a fact. But what worked? Who did it work for? Should we continue with it? Even if things are restored to normality, do we really need to have so many in-person meetings, so many interactions, so many travels? How to invite the workforce who has migrated back to their home place to, again, remote place? All the challenges remain. If we talk about the entire economy, then challenges are manifold. If we talk about the HR practices too, things are required to be redefined, and it remains, if we talk about the entire industry or if we talk about the entire economy, it remains a big challenge, and especially when leading executives like Dilip, Sanjeev and Rakeshji, you also agreed that more than 50% people are going to be laid off, then yes, the challenges will remain for HR too. How to manage the frustration, how to manage the uncertainty, how to manage the doubts of the people who are working with you. So wonderful session. Congratulations to all. I'm highly obliged. And I believe that all the participants must have gained a lot with these deliberations and discussions. And I would request the faculty member, whosoever are there from different institutions, to select this subject for a case study also. And try to contact different company executives so that you can come out with the success stories as well as failure stories. Both are important. Both needs to be studied and both are important to talk about and to be put forth for partner business. Thank you. Thank you very much to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, all the speakers. On behalf of entire GLBMR family, I would like to express my gratitude to Major General Dilawar Singh Ji, Sanjeev Kumar Ji, Dilip Sinha Ji, and Rakesh Seth Ji for sparing their valuable time and sharing immense knowledge with us. I would also like to extend sincere thanks to our Director, Dr. Ajay Kumar Sir, and Shri Pankaj Agarwal Ji, our Vice Chairman, for organizing this knowledge-enriching and informative session. Thank you all for being so participative and attentive throughout the session. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, Ajay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. And I can tell you that the losses or the job losses will be much lesser.
Thank you.
Difficulties
will be lesser. Positive hope, sir.
Sir, muh mein ghee shakkar.
Thank you.
Aisa hi ho. Aisa hi ho.
No. Hum honge kamyab.
Okay, sir. Right. Thank you very much. Thank you.
All the best. Jai Hind and Jai Hind, everybody. Jai Hind.
Jai Hind, sir.
Jai Hind, sir.
Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.
Jai Hind, sir.